In the previous video, we talked about the equilibrium of rigid bodies with 2D, or coplanar forces. Now we're upgrading to problems with rigid bodies that are subjected to three-dimensional force systems. With that comes x, y, and z axes. So that means we can have three support reactions along with three couple moments. The process to solve these problems is pretty similar to before, but now we're just working with everything expressed in Cartesian form. So if we have an object like this, and we have these forces affecting it, for this object to stay in equilibrium, in other words, not move, all the x components added together must equal zero. The same goes for y components and z components. The same is also true for moments. So if we calculate the moment about a point or an axis, the components must equal to zero, otherwise the object wouldn't be in equilibrium. Each object will have different supports, and each support will have different reactions. Your textbooks will have a list of these, so please take a look. In addition, to solve these problems, you must know how to express forces in Cartesian form and how to find moments. If you need a refresh or forgot, please take a look at the description. Now let's get to some examples and go through how to solve them. In this problem, we need to figure out the reactions at the ball and socket joint and the tensions in the wires. The sign has a mass of 100 kilograms, so the vector for weight will be straight down and it will only have a k component. So now, we need to think about the support reactions. At A, we have a ball and socket joint, that means we will have three reactions, one in the x direction, one in the y direction, and another in the z direction. We will assume that these reactions face the positive x, y, and z axes. Since the ball can rotate inside the socket, no moment reactions will be created about point A. For the two wires, we will have two forces going from point B towards C and D. We have to express the force in the wires in Cartesian form. To do that, we first need two position vectors from B to C and B to D. Next, we need to find the magnitude of each position vector. Now we find the unit vector by dividing each term in the position vector by the magnitude. Lastly, we can express each force in the wire. So we're just multiplying the magnitude, which we don't know yet, by the unit vector. Okay, now we can equate the components. So what we are saying is that for this sign to not move around, all the forces in the x direction has to add up to zero. The same for y direction and the z direction. Let's start with the x-axis forces. So we have the x-axis reaction at A, and then the I component of wire BC and the I component of wire BD. All of that added together has to equal zero for this object to stay in equilibrium. Next, y-axis forces. It's the same as before, but now we're just looking for forces in the y-axis. Lastly, we have the z-axis forces. Don't forget the weight of the sign. Notice how we have three equations with four unknowns, so we need one more equation. That's going to be a moment equation, and we will write it about point A. We will first calculate the moment created about point A by the two wires. To do that, we need a position vector from A to B. That's where our two-wire forces start. So let's calculate each individual moment created by the wires. First, wire BC. Next, we calculate the moment created about point A by wire BD. Now we need to figure out the moment created by the weight about point A. For that, we need a position vector from A to G. We actually only need a position vector to the vertical distance of point G along bar AB because its line of action crosses the bar. Let's calculate the moment created about A by the weight. Now for the object to stay still, all of the moments added together must also equal zero. Also, keep in mind that since we wrote our moment equation about point A, the reactions at A won't create any moments. Now, just using our moment equation, we can actually figure out FBC and FBD. All we're going to do is equate the components to zero. So we equate all the I components to zero and all the K components to zero. We don't have any J components, so we don't need to worry about it. Solving the two equations gives us the forces in the two cables. Now using the values we just found, we can solve the other three equations for the unknown reactions at A. Those are our answers. Let's take a look at this problem where we need to find the reactions at the fixed support A. The first step is to express each force in Cartesian form. The 400 Newton force is along the x-axis, so it'll only have a I component. It's negative because it's facing right and our x-axis faces left. The 500 Newton force is along the y-axis, so it'll only have a J component. And lastly, the 600 Newton force is along the z-axis, so that will only have a K component. It's negative because it's downwards, while the z-axis faces upwards. Now since it's a fixed support at A, we know there will be 6 reactions, 3 forces and 3 couple moments about each axis. To figure out the 3 force reactions, we just need to write 3 equilibrium equations, one for each axis. Let's start with the x-axis forces. We only have 2 forces, the x reaction at A and the 400 Newton force. Next, y-axis forces. Lastly, z-axis forces. Now let's solve all the equations to get the reactions. Notice that we got a negative value for Ay. All it means is that while we assume the reaction at A to point in the y direction, in reality, it's facing the other way. Now we need to figure out the moment reactions about point A. To do that, we need to calculate the moment created by each force about point A. So first, we need position vectors from A to where each of the forces are being applied from. Now let's calculate each moment created about point A by each force starting with the 400 Newton force. Next, the 500 Newton force. Lastly, we have the 600 Newton force. Now all the moments added together must equal zero, otherwise the object would be moving. We also include the reaction moments at point A as well. Note that for the moment about the z-axis, we only have the reaction. Now we can equate each of the components to zero. Solving gives us our answers. In this question, there are 3 smooth journal bearings at A, B, and C, and we need to figure out the reactions. So our first step is to figure out what type of reactions are created at the bearings. Normally, smooth journal bearings will have 2 reaction forces that act perpendicular to the shaft and 2 couple moments. However, the couple moments are usually not applied if the object is supported at other places. This is the case with this example. Since we have 3 supports, the couple moments will not be applied. So each smooth journal bearing will have 2 reactions that are perpendicular to the shaft. At A, we would have a reaction in the x direction and the z direction. B would also have the same 2 reactions. At C, we would have a reaction in the y direction and a reaction in the z direction. I just want to show you why there won't be a reaction in the y direction at A and B. Imagine we remove this part and we push on the rod from the side. Notice how it can slide through the support. That means the smooth journal bearing cannot apply a reactive force to stop it from going along the y-axis. Now if we put back the section we removed before, the bearing at C would prevent the whole piece from moving in the y direction because here, the bearing stops the movement in the y direction while not applying a reactive force in the x direction. This is also why moments aren't created because the object is supported at multiple places. Now let's write an equation of equilibrium for the y-axis forces since we would only have one unknown. Solving gives us the y reaction at C. Now how can we find the z reaction at C? The easiest way is to write a moment equation about the y-axis. Only 2 forces create a moment about the y-axis in addition to the z component at C. Since we're going to figure out the moment using a scalar method, so just multiplying forces by perpendicular distance instead of the cross product, we have to be careful about our positive and negative signs. To figure out the positive and negative signs, make sure to use the right-hand rule. So we have the reaction in the z direction times the perpendicular distance to the y-axis, then we have the 600 Newton force times 0.6 meters, and lastly, we have the 900 Newton force times 0.9 meters. The 900 Newton force causes a clockwise moment, so it'll be negative. Now let's solve. So we figured out 2 of the reactions, let's figure out the other 4. We will write an equation of equilibrium for the x-axis forces. Next, an equation for the z-axis forces. Don't forget, we already found the z component at C. Now we have 2 equations with 4 unknowns, which definitely means we need more equations. Those will be moment equations. For the first one, we will write it about the x-axis. Keep in mind that forces like the 500 Newton one, or the x reactions at A and B, won't create any moments about the x-axis since their line of action goes through it. Now a moment equation about the z-axis. Let's solve. Next, we can plug these 2 values we found into our force equations. Solving gives us our answers. That should cover the types of problems you will face when it comes to rigid bodies subjected to three-dimensional force systems and solving for unknown reactions. I hope this video helped, and if it did, please consider sharing it with your friends and classmates. They too might find it helpful. Thanks for watching and best of luck with your studies.